Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for attending this debate this afternoon as we wind up this symposium here at the University of Western Sydney, Translation and Research. It's going to be a well-fought and it will be clean battle. I've spoken to both teams, so we're looking forward to it. Can I take you through the rules first? Now, each speaker has a maximum of 10 minutes. The speakers will choose to sit or stand as they choose. It's in their hands. There is a three-minute summation by the lead speaker at the end. And then that's where you come in. By a show of hands, you will adjudicate which team wins this particular event. Technology, well, it surrounds us, as you can see. It totally engulfs us. It is with us every waking moment, and then you could probably argue while we are sleeping as well. It certainly plays a part. In fact, it's fair to say we are probably married to it. And just like wedded bliss, it's for better or worse. And that's what we're here to debate. The topic is, or the statement at least to debate, is technology is de-skilling the translation profession. We'll find out in just a moment. Let's go through the teams, if I may. Leading off for the affirmative is Mr. Uli Priester. Round of applause, please. A professional interpreter and translator in German English and founder and editor of Anglo-German Communications. He's a senior practitioner at AUSIT. Second off will be Sue Piper. A winner of the 2009 AUSIT National Excellence in Translation Award, over 15 years of professional experience as a translator, interpreter, Indonesian English. And then, to round it all off, for the affirmative, of course, Professor Anthony Pym. World-recognised authority in translation studies with some 18 books behind him. He teaches at Tarragona in Spain, of course, where he is a director of the doctoral and master's programs in translation and intercultural studies. Well, that is the affirmative taken care of. What of the negative? First off, Sam Berner. A professional translator and director of Arabic language experts based in Brisbane. She is the national president of the Australian Institute of Interpreters and Translators. With her, her colleague today, number two, will be Lachlan Simpson. Is translation and interpreting studies technology a manager at Monash University, and he will be the only one coming from a computer science mode. It'll be interesting to hear what Lachlan has to say rather than the humanities. And third, and definitely not the last, but will be the last in terms of the debate, will be Claudia Koch-McQuillan. Claudia, please, round the applause. Is an experienced English-German freelance translator and conference interpreter and subtitler. She also tutors in the Master of Arts in Interpreting and Translation Studies at the Uni of New South Wales. I've gone through the rules, so without any further ado, a maximum of 10 minutes, as I said. Let's go first with Uli Priester for the affirmative.
Thanks very much. I want to start by quoting a few definitions about de-skilling that I found on the internet. My friend Michael put me onto that. De-skilling.
It's a cyborg technology.
Yeah. De-skilling is the process by which skilled labor within an industry or economy is eliminated by the introduction of technologies operated by semi-skilled or unskilled workers. This results in cost savings due to lower investment in human capital and reduces barriers to entry, weakening the bargaining power of the human capital. It is criticized for decreasing quality, demeaning labor, rendering work mechanical rather than thoughtful, and making workers automatons rather than artisans, and undermining community. Now, is this happening? De-skilling is, in my opinion, in fact, happening in our industry in two ways. The technology that is available opens up translation to unskilled people, people who have previously nothing or very little to do, had to do with translation. And it is also de-skilling each and every one of us who still are operating as translators and interpreters. I will go into more detail shortly. For instance, when I used to receive phone calls from people saying, I have a text here which seems pertinent to what I'm researching or the case that I'm working with. Can you translate it for me? Nowadays, they ring and say, I have this text here and had it machine translated through a technology that is available to on the internet. And I know that this and this section is important for me. Can you please translate it? So technology is taking away work from us and is, in that regard, de-skilling us in a very important way. Anybody can run these machine translation programs, and the whole area is being opened up to non-skilled labor, exactly as the definition has outlined. I found another translation, definition on the free dictionary, which affirms what was said before and adds another aspect to it. To downgrade a job or occupation from a skilled to a semi-skilled or unskilled position. I think that is what is indeed going on. Translators are not regarded as important contributors to a process as they used to be. Instead, any person who has the ability to call up a program on the internet can do it. A massive de-skilling process is going on. Another definition from the Collins English Dictionary, which, again, only the second aspect I'm quoting from, de-skilling, a process to cause skilled persons or a labor force to work at a job that does not utilize their skills. This is something that I have been observing among colleagues. Many previously full-time translators are looking for other work. They are working as teachers, admin persons, all kinds of additional jobs are being taken up, and in that regard, the whole profession is getting de-skilled. Now, I want to move on to another technology that is widely used in the profession, namely computer-aided translation. What does that do to us? Computer-aided translation, you will all be familiar with it. It creates a narrowing space of language. Previously, we translated each and every document that we got from scratch and created something new. And nowadays, we have a set of terminology on our computer that we are following. And it is the whole translation process is being streamlined. There is no creativity in that process anymore. It is put on a track, and we are following that track that we have created ourselves by using the computer-aided translation technology. Another way of how the profession is getting de-skilled is by transferring the work that we did to other professions, such as, for instance, technical writers. I used to earn, say, a good 40% of my income by translating German technical manuals into English. That is not happening anymore because German companies are nowadays employing German native speakers who are technical writers and who are writing these manuals in English from scratch. That may be pretty limited English, but it is enough, apparently. And in that regard, we are losing that field that was a big chunk of our work in the past, and our profession is massively being de-skilled that way. It does not only apply to German, although in German it is more prominent than in other languages. Okay, I want to rest my case at this point. Thank you.
Thank you, Uli. Uli Christa there, leading off for the affirmative. Now to start the ball rolling for the negative, please, a round of applause for Sam Berner.
The technology is not the skilling us. We are the skilling ourselves. We're the skilling ourselves by refusing to see the fact that what we used to do 10, 15 years ago is no longer tenable or feasible as a business proposition. And as such, we need to acquire new skills to remain in the profession. Let me remind you, about 4 centuries ago, there used to be those guys balding on the top wearing bathroom robes who used to make heaps of money sitting at their very ergonomically unhealthy lecterns, scribbling. And then one little German guy, it's always Germans.
Sorry.
Was one little German guy who started it all, let's remember, by looking at some goldsmiths and wine presses, as a result of which all these balding little guys went home and stopped scribbling. And the outcry was so big then that the Catholic Church deemed a printed Bible a sin. We're doing the same. We are de-skilling ourselves. Now, books are still being printed, and we have e-publishing coming, so printing is changing as well, and publishers are de-skilling themselves by refusing to go online. We are being worried about the fact that we won't be producing translations. Well, we will be producing something else, because language is not just being used to translate. And at the core of it, as translators, we work with language. So that core skill is not going to disappear. It is just going to be repackaged, and it's going to provide a different service. Four centuries after the German found out about goldsmiths and wine presses, another almost homeless, broke Frenchman this time sent all the little kids that used to carry bobbins in their hands and move little pieces of wood from one end to the other and one end to the other home. They beat him up and threw him into the river as a result, but we are now, as a result, having a computer. Do you know what I'm talking about? Jacquard, he produced the lace-making mills, and they used to be 2 meters a day, and it cost heaps, and the market could never be satisfied. And he created the first hold program. So the lace could be programmed so that the whole picture was in little holes and they could produce 20 meters a day. So of course the lace prices dropped up a little. And of course all these kids that used to hold bobbins went home. But we're still producing lace. Now what happened is that the lace became a luxury item. So people who will have the money will buy lace. There's good lace and there's cheap lace. And some people will want to go for cheap lace, and some people will want to go for Gucci. And the same is going to happen to us. Some of us will continue producing Gucci, some of us will produce cheap lace, but we will not stop producing the lace. We have to just rethink. First of all, we have 2 things. We are saying it is de-skilling the profession. We have to redefine profession. We have to redefine skill. We have to repackage ourselves, and if this profession and these skills no longer make sense, then they are not skills, and it's not a profession, and no one is de-skilling us. We just stop existing because we have chosen to. I rest my case.
Thank you, Sam. Sue Piper is next for the affirmative.
Thank you, Sam. On behalf of the Industrial Revolution, are we going to welcome the third wave? Technology is de-skilling the translation profession. Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues and friends, today I want to speak to you on behalf of the repressed and the suppressed. On behalf of those non-digital natives, yes, the majority of us here, who are feeling traumatized, frustrated, angry, and downright stupid for not getting the damn program to work. Whether we work in a large institution with Lachlan down the hall, or working at home in our home office with our tracky dacks. Yes, technology has a lot to offer us, but it is lowering the threshold into the profession, it's increasing pressures on existing translators and resulting in poorer quality translations that need reworking, post-editing for 2 cents a word. It's a scenario of more and more, faster and faster, for less and less. I don't know if you've seen online the cartoons by, in Mox's blog, Spanish, Alejandro Moreno Ramos in Madrid, Spain. If you haven't seen him, please Google Mox. There's a wonderful selection of cartoons there. And they star Mox, who's a young but well-educated translator. He's got 2 PhDs, 6 languages, and he hardly earns the minimum wage. Another star in the cartoon is Pam, the evil PM, the project manager at a big translation agency whose hobbies include torturing freelancing translators, just for fun. And Bill, the direct client, is head of department in a multinational. He believes that a translator is someone who speaks languages. Our team says that technology is de-skilling the translation profession. Let's remind ourselves, what skills do we have as translators? We've built up over our lifetimes the skill of the ability to write clearly and expertly in our native language, an excellent grasp of our source language, patience to understand what is read as a complete whole, the possession of a vast and highly flexible vocabulary, sensitivity to a wide range of linguistic registers, extensive knowledge of our particular sector and broad cultural knowledge, familiarity with not just what the text means, but with how it means, proficiency at editing, and a keen eye and processes for proofing and overall quality assurance. Plus, not forgetting the important business skills of being an accountant, IT manager, web designer, publicist, client manager, etc., etc. Technology has given us a raft of tools, word and data processing suites, character and voice recognition programs, internet search tools, etc., etc. And our shelves of dictionaries have largely been replaced by online resources and CD-ROM. But it is largely the combination of MT and TM software that is giving us PMT, or the male equivalent. Translators need to invest more time, more money, ever increasing more time and more money into acquiring new technologies for decreasing returns. Any advantage we gain from mastering CAT tools is vastly outweighed by pressures to reduce fees and turnaround time due to shared TMs and fuzzy matches. Yes, speedy data matching is data processing is possible. Especially if you've got repeat business with the same clients. But this does not apply to all projects. And yes, we can use a combination of machine translation and CAT tools, but do you really want to process not just 2,500 words a day, but up to 15,000? With the apparent ease of bulk translation come tightened deadlines. In an ideal world, one can manage data flow, but as freelancers, in a feast or famine scenario that we're all familiar with, we've classically made unreasonable demands on ourselves, and this is getting worse. At what cost to our physical and mental welfare? Not to mention job satisfaction and quality control. We are abandoning a whole text approach for a segmented focus with little time for quality control. We still teach students to first read and understand the text. research where needed, then translate, edit, and proofread. Yet out there in the workforce, you acquire meaning as you go. Such familiarization, pre-familiarization with the co-text is a luxury. And the Q&A stage of editing and proofing, probably light on too. Don't tell the client, but if they're paying 6 cents a word, well, they're not paying for a Jaguar anyway, and will they notice? Sam wants us to celebrate industrialization. Well, technology is turning professionals into process workers with commensurate fees. Technology has enabled us to seek clients and work in teams across the globe, yet we're also competing with translators across the globe, many living in countries with much lower costs of living. And international translation rates are diving more dramatically than a World Cup footballer.
From Italy.
They weren't indeed. As you can see, if you're a member of ProZ, read on the forum discussions, the blogs, the other translator social networks, etc., etc. Rates commonly offered on pros nowadays, 6 cents a word for translations, 2 cents a word for revision. These are not living wages, not in Australia. Hence, Wendell Rickard's two-month-old movement, no peanuts. I don't know if you're familiar with this guy, but he's a self-styled sedition monger. Professional translators and interpreters deserve to stop working for peanuts and earn a living wage for their work.
As does everyone.
Indeed. We do. Yes, experienced translators do need to act proactively and, having vented our fears, stop operating in panic mode. But quality translations are worth more. Skill and experience do count and are saleable. We can work on finding our niche, but these are niche markets, and niche markets are not going to be able to accommodate all the translators and interpreters are out there employed now, not to mention the ones that are coming out of our educational institutions. So what do we do? Do we diversify, as Uli mentioned? Or are we happy to go with the times and express post-edit high-volume, routine, repetitive tasks, texts that have been machine-translated by non-native speakers? Doesn't hold much appeal to me. I rest my case.
Our thanks to Sue Piper. Keep your hands together for our next speaker. For the negative, Lachlan Simpson.
Hi, I don't really use paper very much anymore. I still read, though. So the contention is that technology is de-skilling the translation profession. I'd contend that actually a better question would be that technology is making it harder for translators to make a living, but it's certainly not de-skilling. In fact, I'd change it to that the level of a translator's engagement with technology is a representation of their skill. And I don't think there's probably anyone in this room that didn't use the internet to apply to this conference, right? Or didn't not have an email account a decade ago and now does. No one feels disadvantaged from having had to have learnt how a fax machine works or a photocopying machine works, even though 20 years ago, as I can't remember quite who I was talking with this about, but I remember my father coming home with a fax machine and thinking, wow, fax machine in the house, rock and roll. And now, if someone said to me, you send me a fax, I'd laugh at them. But I still know how to use a fax machine, and I don't feel that I've lost anything from that. Same with the photocopier. It was pretty much the day Ignacio asked me to do this. There was a post on my favourite blog called Boing Boing by one gentleman who suggested, who brought up Riepel's Law, which was written in 1913 about the introduction of the printing press to the newspaper industry in particular. He was a German gentleman, and he ran a newspaper or owned a newspaper, and his quote was, or the law is, new further developed types of media never replace existing modes of media and their usage patterns. Instead, a convergence takes place in that field, leading to a different way and field of use for the older form. I think there's still space for, as we spoke about, boutique translations or bespoke translations. Once, yes, there are going to be a lot more people who can do translation. And I think the idea that that is bad for the translation industry is misguided, because I think that in the same way that rock and roll brought music to the people or what have you, yes, a lot more people can use it now, but there's still room. People still make vinyl records. DJs love them. They spend thousands of dollars on them every week. But we were calling the death of, you know, video killed the radio star. I read a report yesterday that the iPhone has increased the number of people who listen to radio, because now they listen to podcasts. TV killed the radio star in 1983, and the iPod brought it back in 2010. I think there's nothing to fear from an increase in technology in your industry, but don't think that the industry is going to stay the same. Yes, it's going to change. The people who are going to be most affected are the people who are in that industry at the moment. That's unfortunate. But it doesn't actually leave you with nowhere to go. There's plenty of places to go. You just need to think about it and acknowledge that technology is already in your life, and bringing on another one is not going to make you less skilled. It's going to make you more skilled and better at your job. Another point I had was the dropping prices from translation agencies is probably doing more to de-skill the industry than anything. And I think that, as the opposition noted, a translator's union is a wonderful thing, and translators should get together and fight back against, I mean, I'm an anarchist, the capitalist system is at fault here, you know. And hey, the reality that we all work under is that if you can get a translation or anything, let's face it, that's 80% correct in 20 seconds for free, you are always going to take that over something that takes 3 weeks and costs you $1,000. Why wouldn't you? It is sad that that means that translators have less money to work with, but it doesn't actually mean that you're out of work. I think if you can go back to those translation agencies and say, you're not open enough, you're not free enough, you're not giving the TMs back to us, you're not giving us enough TMs, you're not paying enough, basically, then that is another way to stop the erosion of your income, which is the bigger issue, I think. People are scared about their incomes. Fair enough. Fair enough. There was a comic I showed yesterday. I would like to show it today, but I can't, which basically showed how to become more technically skilled. And the essence of the comic is find a button that looks like it does what you want it to do and click it. And if it didn't, try another button. And if you've been doing it for more than half an hour, ask someone else. And that's, you know, we're not talking about you have to become computer programmers, although you have to start thinking more in terms of computer science, but we are saying you need to become better at using your computer and using the tool that is in front of you and feel more confident that you can use the software that comes next or the process that comes next, including not just MT and TM, but business software, time management software, project management software, Wikipedia, or wikis in general. There are a lot of... it's the point at the end of my talk, but essentially, if you read the blogs, listen to the podcasts, and stay on top of the news, that's probably as much as you need to do at a minimum. If you then engage with that community, you're actually in an awesome position, because the industry is about to go through a massive change, and nobody knows where that change is going to take us. But it is going to take us somewhere. Are we going to embrace the technology and help it take us to a place where we want to be? Or are we going to stand outside and be scared and let the corporations dictate how it's going to be? I would suggest that the best thing for a translator to do is to become engaged. Sorry, to become engaged in the online communities in particular, and to ask, I want this, I want that. I use Amiga T, it doesn't do this. I'm on the Amiga T mailing list, and it happens weekly. Someone writes in and says, why can't I do this? And the developers either say, well, because, or it's expensive. And, you know, if you want to pay for us to implement that, that's fine, but no one really wants to do it. But at least, you know, if you have 20 people on an email list who say, I really want this feature, after a while, the people who develop the software think, you know what, that's a 20th person who's asked for that. Maybe we should think about it. That's how you make translation go in a way you want to go, technologically, not by sitting on the outer. Thanks. So just quickly to finish off, there was two more points I wanted to make. The first one was that translators and interpreters know that the real skill within your industry is the dual knowledge, or if you're lucky enough to be multilingual, of language and culture for both of those cultures that you're engaged with. You really have to see computer science as a meta-culture that fits on top of that understanding and helps mediate your ability to do the work that you do, rather than as a foreign culture that is imposing itself upon you and that you have no access to. You can still learn it. You've learned at least one other language. You've learned how to use email. You've learned how to use a photocopier. Your engagement with this meta-culture that will help span those two is only going to make you a better translator. And that's all I've got to say. Thank you very much for having me.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're at the business end now, the last speakers, and leading the last part for the affirmative will be Anthony Penn.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, look, the proposition, in case you've forgotten, is that, what is it, technology is de-skilling the translation profession. Right? I have to rephrase it because I'm getting very confused here. I've heard good arguments on this side in favor of the proposition and good arguments on that side in favor of the proposition. Are you as confused as I am? Now, let's get down to this. I'll give you something I am sure of. Here's the image I've got. My family has a farm, as Australians tend to do. And at one stage in my life, I used to get letters from my uncle, my father's brother, who was the last farmer to actually work the farm, about what should happen to the farm. It's a very important family issue. In wonderful copperplate handwriting that some of you might be able to produce and most of you can remember, perhaps from your school days. And I was always embarrassed because I had to reply to these letters of some importance, and my handwriting, even at that stage, and now, God help us, it's even worse, could never imitate that. And yet this form of communication was entirely inappropriate to the one thing I could do, which was a typed letter. Come on, Lachlan, you're saying that the old skills don't disappear. How's your handwriting? Can you even hold a book these days? Come on. It's just not true that old skills don't disappear, that new things come in and we get this accumulation. It's a fact of human life. When your attention has to go to new skills, I'm pretty good on a computer, we're losing the old skills. My handwriting is hard for me to read even now. Your argument, Lachlan, is basically saying there is no de-skilling at all anywhere, which is just counterfactual and is not helping anybody and certainly not helping your particular argument in that case. Other things you're saying, come on, you can tell he's an IT guy. These guys have to hide under hats, you can tell. You know? At least some of us can show the source of the stress we've been through. An 80% translation, wow, you would go for that. Let's hope you're not reading pharmaceutical use contents, okay? Let's hope you're not getting instructions from a doctor. 80% of you might survive. But the 20% is going to be, the most important part. Okay, he's taking his hat off. He's getting worried now. Our profession is based on 100% reliability and trust in us as people. It's not a machine producing something that might be 80% good enough for some certain purposes. and that profession is being de-skilled and threatened by the new technologies, which, have we seen, are happy with the 80%. Why not? Okay, 20% of the population might disappear, but come on. It's just statistics, isn't it? Come on, calling on the unions to protect prices. Do a bit of history, mate. Come on. Prices go down because of the technology. It's not hard to join up those dots. Prices go down because more people enter the profession, as you yourself have recognized. Because more people enter, it's easier to get in touch with more people all over the world. In Spanish, you know, it's well known. Argentina is the place that provides the cheapest prices, so whole prices for the whole Spanish translation into the Spanish market go down. Technology is driving it down, and no matter how many unions you've got, the unions tend to be local and national. This technology is internationalizing the market. Sue proved that in her demonstration, and I have no need to launch myself into that. Now, this is where my confusion comes in, okay? Sam had a good go at it. She said, we have to change in order to remain in the profession. And then she said, and I cite, we work with language. And I thought, well, that's interesting. It's a, hey, I'm just getting started. Now, my argument is that the process is getting so acute that the nature of the profession is changed. You can't just stay in a profession. The profession, that place that was once called the profession, has been de-skilled and democratized and spread out. As was said, as you said very, very clearly, there are so many more people who can now do translations. Everybody can do a bit of it. And yes, they're working with language, but we speak, we work with language. We write, we work with language. We read, we work with language. What else we do? We listen, we work with language. Thank you. And we translate. Everybody is working with language all the time. Work with language is not a profession. It's not good enough to say to stay in the profession. It's a profession, we work with language. It's a very, very confused proposition, I'm afraid. You sounded good. You sounded good at the outset, but you got lost in this idea of there being one fixed profession. No, the profession is disappearing. There are two things in this proposition. The technology, we sort of know about that. But look around us. Look what Sue's been saying. Look what Ulu's been saying from within the profession. The sands are disappearing beneath our feet, and we have to rethink the idea of, is there a profession at all? The skills you're talking about are the skills that my 12-year-old children have. And they can do it, and they can operate the internet, and they can do their email, Google, better than most of us. Now, I personally think that that democratization, that de-skilling process, is a very good social thing. I personally think that the proposition is so true that it is good, because I would like to see all cultures interacting with each other, using the technologies, using translation as a part of the way we understand the world and understand each other. Now, there's an argument about whether or not it's good. I think it's good for the world and probably bad for professional translators. But ladies and gentlemen, there can be no argument about the fundamental veracity of the proposition. Technology is de-skilling the profession because the profession itself is disappearing. Thank you for your attention.
I now call on the last speaker, the negative, Claudia Koch-McQuillan.
I think Anthony himself has just weakened his own argument by saying what we're all know about is the 100% reliability. I think that were your own words. I think these days what we really have is the opportunity to be better than ever before, and that is really largely due to technology. I don't think I need to say much about the research abilities that we have, and Anthony's talked about that himself. We all know we've got vast access to online resources, monolingual resources, bilingual resources, glossaries, corpora, you name it. 20 years ago, we just could not do the research we can these days, not even, I mean, 5-10 years ago. It's constantly evolving. So that's pretty obvious fact, but that's not the only one. We also have communication and collaboration. Communication between us, and Lachlan has said that, we have the ability to talk among each other. I have, as a resource, not just what's online, I also have as a resource all my colleagues. And that's something that has happened in the last years, and it's happening more and more, that we talk to each other. I can ask questions about terminology. I can ask questions about understanding of the source text, interpretation. And we do more and more. We've got our language-specific networks. We've got subject-specific networks. We've got AUSIT, where we discuss all sorts of things. We discuss business practices. We discuss ethics. So, and I know that these are trusted resources, generally. So we are creating a community, and I think that can only be a good thing. We are emerging more as a profession, or it allows us to emerge more as a profession, to gain more of a profile. And because we have some sort of unity, whereas before, we did work largely isolated. And I think Anthony's also said, there was this, the main relationship of translators was translator to text rather than translator to another person, to the you, the author, the audience. Whereas now we are much more in a wider context. And in that context, we also collaborate. We now have the ability to really, truly collaborate on projects. We can share online resources. We can work on glossaries simultaneously online. We can share bookmarks for useful projects, for useful resources. I know if I need a reviewer, a proofreader, somebody to work with, I've got this network of trusted contacts, and it is a fluent exchange between us. And again, that was not possible in the past. Without losing time, without various communication difficulties, yes, of course, if the internet's down, then all this falls by the wayside. But let's leave that aside, that possibility. So that communication, collaboration, a huge step forward. And that's not the only thing. The third component is education and training. There's vast resources out there that we did not have access to in the past that can only make us better. Most of us have very irregular working hours. A lot of us have, like Uli said, work different jobs as well. Sometimes it's very difficult, or often it's difficult to predict our workloads. So it's difficult for a lot of us to pursue structured education, training, professional development. But e-learning is a huge development, and it's going to grow very much in the next decade and so on. Now, there's excellent modules for us where we can pursue our training in the areas that we want, at the times that we want and that we have available. So all this together, I think it's really shown, compared to in the past, it's sort of up to us. We can really take our skills much higher than we could ever in the past. And that is all thanks to technology. So again, thank you.
Thank you, Claudia. Well, James, this is the part where I say that you have a minute to regather your thoughts, and then you have a three-minute, wrap-up, a summation, if you like. You can use it as a rebuttal or a confirmation of your own negative or affirmative. So if you'd like to spend a minute...
That's okay.
You're ready to go?
Ready to go.
Anthony, I dare say your first cab off the rank. You have 3 minutes. Anthony, did.
Claudia, that was a good go at attempting to get some clarity into the debate. But look, we've got. Who the hell is we? Everybody's got these things. So you're not talking about the profession. You guys have lost track of the profession. Now this team, ladies and gentlemen, with remarkable Germanic clarity, has defined the terms that we're talking about. We have shown what de-skilling means. Skills are not needed, or the skills we have are underused, and there's a drop in creativity. as Uli has demonstrated, and none of you could possibly doubt. Now, and Sue has presented this from the professional perspective, where we have a lower threshold of entry into the profession, declining quality, declining pay, and all bad things. And I, on the other hand, have argued that exactly these things are happening, and they can be very good socially. I think they are fundamentally good things, but they are bad for the profession because the profession is being undermined. Now, the world's problems are not protecting your profession and your salary. I'm sorry, the big problems in the world involve communication, mistrust, lack of understanding between cultures. Not classes, not nations, cultures. Think about where the wars and the conflicts are. What we need are not necessarily 100% good translations, but we do need people able to mediate between cultures in the names of human cooperation, human understanding, and reliability of mediation. If there are professions around that can help in that, if there are skills around that can help in that, then that's what we need. But those things, cooperation, understanding, reliability, are not in the technology. We rest our case.
For the native, I'm looking over to the team. Sam, have you decided on who will be taking up the ball?
Well, I will.
Sam, ladies and gentlemen.
I was desperately trying not to take a jib at Anthony, but he's left me absolutely no option.
Now, just to recap, what we said is that we now have more than ever resources, more than ever ability to collaborate, more than ever flexibility, and that machine translation and translation memories are actually making our work much faster and much easier. So if we ride the wave, we are not de-skilling ourselves, because our main skill is, and I repeat that, working with language, working in certain ways with language. And if at one point in time we will no longer be able to translate, we will still have the skill to do other things with language, including cultural cross-communication, which was what Anthony was just suggesting. Now, talking about the skilling, I kind of thought, while everybody was talking about Uli's definition, are you reading the Marxist archives these days? Well, the skilling in English means losing skills. I know how to put a screw through a wall. I know how to do that with a kitchen knife and with a screwdriver and occasionally with my nails. Now, how is the screwdriver de-skilling me? Okay? That's one thing. The second thing about this, you know, the absolute reliability. 80% will, you know, is good, actually. If we have 20% people die because they can't ask their doctors to explain things to them, that might help the global warming. So we might actually be of service. No machine translation. And just think about it this way. 20% of those people who die might be bad translators, so you're actually getting a 20% share of the market. Okay. So to recap, we do not lose skills by using tools. We acquire skills by losing tools. We are not becoming the skilled in any way by them.
Thank you to both teams. A spirited and lively debate, I'm sure you'll agree. Now, this is where audience participation comes to the fore. I will ask a question regarding the affirmative and then the negative, and by way of show of hands, which one you support, then we'll decide who the winner is. Okay, for those who support the affirmative, hands in the air, please. Which is this thing.
The good thing.
I will actually have to count this, I think.
Make them shout.
Oh, really? Have we got one of those noisometers by any chance? Let me count, please, hands in the air. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Thank you very much. Now for the negative. That would be one arm per person, thank you. And no, you can't vote twice.
God, we're tied. It's a tie.
You won't quite believe this. It's a tie. I think a casting vote's required.
It's a tie.
Sure. Vote for
the negative. Come on, we go with an arm wrestle. By my count, it's 18-all. So, share it with you. Wonderful way to close it. Ladies and gentlemen, congratulations to both teams. Well played, well debated. One more round of applause, please. Thank you. All right. If I may now call on Associate Professor Sandra Hale to officially close the third annual research symposium. Round of applause, please.
Well, what can I say after that? I won't say much at all, actually, because I don't want it to be an anticlimax. I'd like to thank everybody for coming to our third annual symposium. I think you'll agree that it's been a great symposium, despite the cold and the IT maintenance and the semi-trailer blocking the exit, to the Milfera exit on the M5, the fire alarm, the fire drill. I think it was great. And I think that shows that we are survivors. That we keep going. Regardless, and I do say this seriously, that we do, with everything that we do that has to do with interpreting or translation, we have to fight. Including our courses, our research funding, our rates of pay, our working conditions. We've had to fight ever since we started in this profession. And we'll continue to fight, and we have seen improvements, and I know we will continue to see improvements. And I think that's the secret of it. Don't lose heart. Okay, we'll always be confronted by challenges, and this is one of them. Technology is one of those challenges, and I am challenged by technology. And as Anthony said, my 13-year-old daughter knows a lot more about technology than I do, and I've got someone at home now who's an expert, which is good. So that's my message, that we continue to fight, we continue to improve, we continue to work together to achieve results, and I am confident that we will. And it's not just us, it's the new generation, and the new generation will be literate in technology. So they'll have a head start, but obviously there'll be more technology that they'll have to learn eventually, so more challenges will come up. So thank you again for coming. We've got an evaluation sheet in your bag, which I'd ask to fill and put in that box there for future symposia to help us organise. I'd like to thank again the college, the university, for providing us with the support. I want to thank especially Sylvia Martinez, who is my research. And also Suzanne, who's not here, Suzanne Gapps, who is also our admin coordinator, but we'll tell her that we thanked her. And I want to thank all of you for being here. I want to thank Frank for being an announcer here, who is very well known on TV personality, so he did a great job. And all of the panellists, all of the speakers, and especially Anthony, who came all the way from Europe to come and provide us such. Starting on the 29th of July, and then to next year's symposium, we'll tell you more about that. Thank you again.